In order for you to understand where my work has gone, I kind of need to give you a little bit of background on me. And it did start in the 70s. And the original inspiration occurred when I was a first-year fine arts student at the University of Manitoba. I was walking through the Winnipeg Art Gallery, and the boardroom door was open. Inside the boardroom, I saw a lamp over the board table that consisted of a chrome bar with several chrome bars, actually, with spheres of glass and lights inside. A very 70s kind of thing. And when I saw that lamp, I thought to myself, my God, I mean, what a thing. I mean, glass, what a great way to make sculpture, because I saw this lamp as being very sculptural. And I decided on the spot after seeing this lamp that I wanted to go to Europe, apprentice myself in a glass factory, and become what I thought would be the world's first contemporary glass artist. I'd never heard of Dale Chihuly or my teacher Marvin Lepofsky, but I did go and talk to some of my professors at the university, and they told me about a guy by the name of Dale Chihuly and a school that he had in Washington called Pilchuck. And that year I applied to Pilchuck. Unfortunately, it was full. They recommended a school in upstate New York, which I attended, and learned how to blow glass that summer. Teacher's name was Bill Carlson, who teaches in Chicago. Having that experience, I then went to decided that I needed to find a school where I could actually learn how to blow glass in a good accredited school and spend a period of time. So I discovered the California College of the Arts with the department head of Marvin Lepofsky, who was one of the great fathers of the studio glass movement. So I went to California, became his one of his students. So in my final year, I happened to be in the car with Marvin coming back from a concert at another college, and I had this vision that I really wanted to create massive walls of sculpted glass. I mentioned to Marvin, I said, you know, Marvin, I want to make giant walls of glass. I have this vision, and they've got to be thick and sculptural, and I don't know how I'm going to do it, but that's what I want to do. And his comment was, well, Warren, you know, I know you can do it. Go for it. So that's what I did. I left California. I came back to Canada, and I started to set up my first studio. And I started working with 3/4-inch thick glass. It came to me kind of in an epiphany one evening that if I could work with glass that was thick enough, I wouldn't need to use lead lines. And if I found other ways of applying color, if I fired it in, I wouldn't need to use colored stained glass. I could free myself up. Anything I could draw, I'd be able to do in the glass. And I started experimenting, doing different things, using acid etching, sandblasting, carving, laminating with optically clear adhesives, doing a number of different things to try and give me what it was that I wanted. And eventually, I kind of got to where I am here, you know, building giant walls of glass. One of the things that has become very common for me is to use 19 millimeter thick glass. Sometimes I fire colors in, sometimes I use them cold. I use a variety of different techniques to create it. This piece is in the Canadian Embassy in Tokyo. The architect is Raymond Moriyama from Toronto. And it was quite a pivotal piece for me. It was my first large international public art piece. And when I flew out to Toronto to meet with Moriyama, he told me that he had designed his building to reflect ikebana, which is the Japanese art of flower arrangement. I love the idea that it had its own philosophy, and I really wanted to work with that. I like things that are rather ironic. I like dichotomies and things of that sort. I also noticed that in doing my research that there were houses in Japanese gardens and tea houses that had a particular roof style. And in the University of Manitoba Architecture Library, I found that actually early Manitoba farmhouses and stables had a very similar look, same kind of thatched roofs. So I incorporated that into the piece as well, and it came out looking a little bit like this. The philosophy of Ikebana is heaven, earth, and man is symbolized by the colors of yellow, blue, and green, by the shapes of a triangle, a rectangle, and a circle, and that curved piece is a portion of a circle, and the directional forces of vertical, diagonal, and horizontal. The triangles are pointing horizontally. Moriyama also told me that in his building, he had this escalator in front of my piece was the entrance to what he referred to as the Earth Zone, and that he designed it with a triangular shape, so as you go down the escalator, you have the sensation of the Earth closing in over your head. And I really like that notion, and I wanted to play with it. So I put some glass rocks at the bottom of my piece to kind of tie in with that notion and to tie my relatively two-dimensional piece into the three-dimensional world of the architect. This is a detail of some of the carving in the piece, and it also shows a little bit of the structure. And the structure was also very important in this piece. So when I had an opportunity to do this piece in Japan, I wanted to devise a method that would give me to completely get away from the steel and allow me to have a piece that, even though there were 91 panels, that I wouldn't have to have steel mullions in between. So I designed this piece to have a support structure that runs up the back. There are, I believe, five of them, and they are actually tripod configurations. I did it so that there are three one-inch bars running up the back. With outrigger clamps attached to them. This allows me to get away without very much visual interference at all. There's just a little bit of a shadow that's shown, and each piece is connected to the support structure by a 2x2-inch stainless steel piece at each intersection of the glass. This is going up from that escalator, and the piece is at the top.